The word purgatory is defined in the Webster's Dictionary in modern English as a place or a state of torment, an interment or a state after death for exemplatory purification, specifically a place or a state of punishment where, according to the Roman Catholic doctrine, the souls of those who die in God's grace may make supplication for past sins and so become fit for heaven. And now in the Roman Catholic doctrine, it is a place or a state for suffering inhabited by the souls of sinners who are compensating for their sins before going to heaven. Now that we have the definitions out of the way, let's look at some of the quotes from catechism class. All who die in God's grace and fellowship but still are imperfectly purified are indeed assured of their eternal salvation, but after death they undergo purification, as to achieve the holiness necessary to enter the joy of heaven. The church gives the name of purgatory as the final purification. Next quote. In the Catholic teachings, purgatory is basically a midway state where the individual is purified from his sins, which are not dealt with while living on this earth. This describing those in purgatory as being imperfectly purified. They are also described as failing to achieve the holiness necessary to enter the joys of heaven. Also states that all who die in God's grace and fellowship, but are still imperfectly purified, are indeed assured of their eternal salvation, but after death they must undergo purification so as to achieve the holiness necessary to enter the joys of heaven. The church gives the name purgatory to this final purification. Note, it says the church, not Yahweh God, not the Bible, his word. Now, this Catholic teaching tells people they still have a burden of sin, debt, that has to be purified through the fires of the punishment of purgatory. Roman Catholic supporters must have to continue to work for their holiness. But yet, Jesus paid for our sins. We do not have to work to have this burden removed. He took them away on the cross. He took all of our burdens, all of our sins upon himself. I have a question for them. Whatever happened to the end of the Bible in Revelations, where it says, "For I testify unto every man that hears the word of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add to these things, God shall add unto him plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifies these things, saying, Surely I come quickly, amen, even though come, Lord Jesu." Now the Roman Catholic Catechism teaches that Jesus' death on the cross guaranteed people of their eternal, unending salvation, but he did not flawlessly cleanse their souls so they could directly go to heaven. And the Roman Catholic believers must have to continue to work for their holiness. This makes the people of these beliefs having to achieve holiness necessary to enter the joys of heaven. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he only did part of the job, giving up his life for us. It's true that God offers salvation to us as a free gift, and the reason is because Jesus Christ has already paid the price for it by giving his life for us. And the Bible says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." That's Romans 6:23. 1 John 2:2 says, "He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And thereby we do know that we know him. We keep his commandments." 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also has suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, but put to death the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit." It's talking about the Holy Spirit. We're supposed to live in the Spirit and let the flesh die. In the Catholic article discussing why is it that the fundamental Christians will not accept the teachings of purgatory? It says the main reason for such strong opposition of purgatory is that it can't coexist with the fundamentalization, foundationalism's notion of salvation. Now, the foundationalism of salvation comes from accepting Christ as one's personal savior. Aside from all that one act of acceptance, no acts meaning no good deeds, no sins, can make difference in respect to one's salvation. Catholics are taught through their supernatural torments, they will confront themselves with the thought that this torment is just temporary in purgatory. And soon I will come out of this place and see the light and go to heaven. Now, Jesu Christ tells us of these type of people. They will come out of this temporary place called hell, not purgatory, and are in torment waiting for final judgment because hell is a temporary place of like a prison which the spirits of whom are not born again are inhabited from the moment they die until the time that Jesu Christ calls them forth to be judged. Now, hell is a place of torment. But it is only really a temporary place of internment as jail, as I said. And then they can be permanently judged as in a courtroom of law, same principle, and then cast into the liquid fire for eternity. So there's torment from the time of death throughout eternity for sins. And during this time of punishment in hell, people who believe the Roman Catholic lie about purgatory will be thinking that purgatory does exist and that they will go there to be prayed out of this place. Believing and accepting to go to heaven after the encounter with Christ at judgment seat is a lie. Here in Luke, we are told there is no purgatory. When one of the condemned thieves turned to Jesu Christ asking him to save him, Jesu knew this man's heart because he was moved by his presence and his sin condemned him. We read that in Luke 23:42. And he said unto Jesu, Lord, remember me when thou comes into thy kingdom. And Jesu said unto him, Verily I say unto you, today shalt you be with me in paradise. And the Bible teaches that people who are not born again will be in torment from the time they die in the place called hell. There's no way out. Nowhere in the Bible does it say once you go to hell, you get out. They will remain there until the time they face the great white judgment before Jesu Christ, who will be the judge. Then they will be cast into the liquid fire for eternity. Revelations 20:11-15. Now, if you die, it can be said of you that you are imperfectly pure, says the Catholics, as well as failing to achieve the holiness necessary to enter the joy of heaven. Now, I'm sorry to say that if you are believing this, you are eternally lost. You have been fed a lie. Now, when a person of the old Roman Empire paid off their debt, this word was stamped on their papers to show everyone that their debt had been totally paid in full. So when Jesu Christ said, "It is finished," on the cross, he told everyone from that time forward, he had fully paid for their sin debt. He bought us with his blood, his life. There's no such thing as a balance of sin left over that needs to be cleansed. There is absolutely no reason for purgatory to exist. Jesus' sacrifice paid the sin debt in full on the cross. The word finish, the definition is on your monitor. He was the final sacrifice, as you read in the scriptures that I have scrolling here. Inspecting the Bible bases only by the Roman Catholic theologians teaching on purgatory, and we're going to take a look at them, and then we're going to look at the real source of this teaching. What is purgatory? Now, we've already read this, so I'm just going to put it on the monitor and let you look at it. This is what the Catholic theologians point to. They also point to Matthew 5:25-26 as a basis for purgatory in the Bible. The word prison thus implies this scripture to impose that is supposed to be purgatory. The association in this scripture is also that ultimately the prisoner will pay for his final bill and be set free. This suggestion is held to be constant in the teaching of purgatory. It is not eternal, and eventually everyone will get out of it and go to heaven perfectly purified,
which again is a lie.
Nowhere is that found in the Word. These theologians also point to Jesus' statement of the unpardonable sin as proof of purgatory. If it's unpardonable, it cannot be forgiven. Now, this is being held as proof of purgatory as well. This is Matthew 12 and 32, leaving them to say that this is another Bible basis for purgatory. Either in this world or in the world to come, does imply that some sins are forgiven after death, they are saying. However, it is a strong way of stating the truth that unrepentant sin will never be forgiven, as we see from Ins 12:10 and especially Mark 3:29. Now, the Catholic theologians have had to set their main argument for purgatory in this passage about offering money to pray for the dead is significant to be proved in the lack of divine inspiration in the book of Maccabees. No other book in the Holy Scripture contains this doctrine. It is basically opposite to the Christian teachings. So this idea of teaching and paying for money can relieve the suffering of loved ones in purgatory. Just smells of money-making schemes to make the church rich, because at death, we who are in Christ go to rest, not to a place called purgatory to be purged of our sins, to be prayed out or to be paid out of our... No one can redeem us to pay God a ransom too high the price to redeem life. One would never have enough to stay alive forever and never see the pit. That's Psalms 10, 49. And I have other scriptures here scrolling across. Purgatory is a condemnation, although theoretically temporary. But as we read here in Romans, this last scripture, Romans 8 and 1, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For Jesus himself told us this wonderful truth in John 3:18. Since purgatory is condemnation, it does not, and there's no need for it to exist. Now, in conclusion to this teaching, purgatory is not based on the Bible, as I have just proved, but it's based on extra lies of the Roman Catholic Church, saying that you have two types of sins. You have venial sin and temporary punishment for sin after death. Now, the Catholic Church theologians, a person commit two sins of sins against God. There's a mortal sin and a venial sin. The mortal sin is a grave offense against the law of God and against the church. The church is the bride of Christ. It's not a building. It is called mortal because it kills the soul by depriving it of its eternal sanctification grace. It's not possible. Venial sin is a small and pardonable offense against God and the laws of the church. Both of these are unfounded and lies. Then this confessing an unscriptural doctrine continues. Two kinds of punishment are due for mortal sin: eternal death, which is hell forever, and temporary, which is purgatory. So there you go. There's where it really came from. One place it really came from. The eternal punishment is canceled by the sacraments and baptisms and extreme unctions, or by the act of perfect contribution with a promise of confession. In other words, you got to give some money. Temporary punishment is not negated by these sacraments, but by the works of penance, giving of alms, money, by paying the priest to say a mass, which not in the Bible, by excesses, etc., which reduce the temporal punishment for mortal sins that have to be suffered in purgatory. Thus, even if all mortal sins of the Catholic Church are forgiven in confession by a priest, but the person does not perform enough of these good works, he will go to purgatory and remain there in torture until his soul is completely purified. What a lie.